Right, today we're going to look at the cranial nerves. Now, the cranial nerves are a group of sensory and motor nerves that enter and leave the central nervous system within the cranium, rather than via the spinal cord. They're concerned with the functions in and around the head and the neck. Now, overall, the organisation of these motor and sensory pathways is basically the same as other motor sensory pathways. That is that the sensory pathways have three neurons and the motor pathways have two. Now there are 12 cranial nerves, numbered 1 to 12, unsurprisingly. If you look at the brain from below, the nerves are numbered from number 1 in the frontal lobe to number 12 in the medulla oblongata. We shall start at the beginning, number 1. Cranial nerve number 1 is the olfactory nerve, or more correctly, the olfactory nerves. These are a group of small nerves that project from the nasal mucosa in the nose through a group of small holes in the base of the skull to synapse with mitral cells in the olfactory bulb. Axons from these cells form the olfactory tract and project to a number of cortical areas, including the uncus and the parahippocampal region. Together, these form the primary olfactory cortex. Cranial nerve number 2 is the optic nerve. This leads from the eye to the optic chiasm and contains efferent fibres projecting from the retina. The fibre bundle posterior to the optic chiasm is the optic tract, which is made up of fibres from both optic nerves. Now, having said that the sensory pathways of the cranial nerves follow the same organisation as the sensory pathways in the periphery, the olfactory pathway is the exception. Axons that make up the olfactory tract synapse directly with neurons in the primary cortex rather than projecting via thalamic nuclei. So there's only two neurons in the pathway rather than three. I'm now going to concentrate on the nerves that control the movement of the eyes. There are three of them, and they are all motor nerves. The third cranial nerve is the oculomotor nerve. Its function is really described by its name. It's the major motor nerve that directs movement of the eye. It's quite a large nerve, and it's the only one to emerge from the superior pontine sulcus, near the midline. It innervates the superior, medial, and inferior rectus muscles, as well as the inferior oblique muscle, enabling the eye to be moved in multiple directions, up, down, towards the nose, or medial rotation. It also innervates the muscles that control the opening of the eyelid, as well as the ciliary ganglion, which in turn innervates the constrictor muscles of the iris. So all in all, it's a pretty complex nerve. The lateral rectus muscle is innervated by the abducens nerve, which is cranial nerve number 6. This nerve emerges from the medullary pontine sulcus at the base of the pons, close to the midline, almost directly in line with the oculomotor nerve. This muscle rotates the eye towards the temple, or lateral rotation. The fourth cranial nerve is the trochlear nerve. This is unusual in that it is the only cranial nerve to emerge from the dorsal surface of the brainstem. It follows a path around the cerebral peduncles to innervate the superior oblique muscle, helping the eye to move upwards and medially towards the nose. These three nerves together control the six muscles needed to move the eye. What is remarkable is when you start to think about how different muscles in each eye need to be coordinated in their response to enable both eyes to be moved together to point to the same place. So for instance, to look left, the lateral rectus muscle needs to contract on the left eye, but the medial rectus muscle needs to contract in the right eye. It becomes quite mind-boggling when you think about it too much. Sensory and motor nerves associated with the head and face are cranial nerves 5 and 7, the trigeminal and facial nerves respectively. The trigeminal nerve is the largest of the cranial nerves. It emerges from the lateral pons and, as the name suggests, has three branches: the ophthalmic, maxillary and mandibulary branches, or V1, V2 and V3. All three have sensory functions, bringing touch and pain information from the forehead to the tip of the nose, the cheeks and upper lip, and the lower jaw to chin, respectively. In addition, the mandibulary branch has motor functions in controlling the muscles that enable us to chew our food, or mastication. The facial nerve is also a mixed function nerve. It not only controls the muscles of facial expression, but carries taste sensation from the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. And we should note here that touch sensation from the same region of the tongue is carried by V3 of the trigeminal nerve. The facial nerve emerges lateral to the abducens nerve from the base of the pons. Also emerging from this sulcus is cranial nerve number 8, the vestibulocochlear nerve. The name should tell you what this nerve is all about. It's a purely sensory nerve bringing information from two modalities that are associated with the ears, balance and hearing. Efferents that make up cranial nerve 8 project from the semicircular canals of the vestibular system and from the cochlea in the inner ear. We now move to the final group of cranial nerves, which are found on the medulla oblongata. These are the glossopharyngeal, which is cranial nerve number 9, the vagus, cranial nerve number 10, the accessory, cranial nerve number 11, and the hypoglossal, which is cranial nerve number 12. I'll start with nerves 9 and 12, which are the glossopharyngeal and the hypoglossal. These two nerves together, alongside the pharyngeal branch of the vagus nerve, coordinate the movement of the tongue and pharynx during swallowing and speech. They are found either side of the olive on the medulla oblongata, with the glossopharyngeal nerve emerging dorsal to the olive and the hypoglossal nerve emerging on the ventral side. We should note here that the hypoglossal nerve is the only cranial nerve found in the groove between the olive and the pyramids on the ventral side of the medulla, which makes it easy to identify. The glossopharyngeal nerve is a mixed sensory and motor nerve. It innervates the upper pharynx, or the back of the mouth, and elevates it during swallowing. Temperature, touch and pain information from the pharynx and the posterior third of the tongue is carried by somatosensory fibres, while taste information from this region is carried by visceral fibres. So taste signals from the tongue are carried by the facial and glossopharyngeal nerves, while somatosensory information is carried by the mandibular branch of the trigeminal nerve and the glossopharyngeal nerve. Movement of the tongue itself is achieved via the hypoglossal nerve, which innervates nearly all the muscles of the tongue. Like the glossopharyngeal nerve, the vagus nerve is found emerging from the dorsal side of the olive. Indeed, these two nerves are so intertwined that it can be difficult to separate them. It innervates much of the throat and pharynx, enabling the complex movements required for swallowing and speech. It's also responsible for the gag reflex. It innervates much of the upper body, regulating heart rate, contractions of intestinal smooth muscles, and sweat responses. In addition, it provides the major sensory input to the brain from the visceral organs of the body. All in all, a very complex nerve indeed. And the final nerve to talk about is the accessory nerve. This nerve is unusual in that it emerges from the spinal cord in humans and tracks back into the cranium via the foramen magna. This is a motor nerve that innervates the muscles of the shoulder and neck, allowing the head to tilt and rotate and the shoulders to be raised. And that's it. all the cranial nerves in one nice, quick and easy package. Or maybe not. The cranial nerves are really no different to any other nerves in our bodies. They show the same basic organisation and carry out the same kinds of functions as other nerves. However, we can see from looking at them in detail how innervation from different nerves must be coordinated within a single structure to produce apparently smooth and simple actions. Take eating and swallowing, for instance. You can see from the descriptions I've given you that in order to eat a sandwich, you need coordinated actions of at least four separate nerves to chew and swallow, as well as three sensory nerves to taste what you've just eaten. It gives us a fantastic insight into the complex interactions between brain and the periphery that are required to enable us to function in the great big world. The brain does not exist in splendid isolation in your head, and the cranial nerves beautifully demonstrate why.